Hello there, God bless you. Welcome to today's edition of Practical Theology. Is it just a joke? Part 2. Fences and boundaries in the marriage. How far can we go? In the last edition of Practical Theology, we looked at the importance of honesty and openness in the marriage. Today, I invite us to take a look at another fence. Interaction with the opposite sex. You know, we can't do without boundaries in this area. Whether it's with colleagues at work, business partners, family friends, old friends, new friends, there must be boundaries to the way we can talk and play around with people of the opposite sex. In the area of speech, choice of words, we need to be conscious of the way we talk to people of the opposite sex, especially when one or both of us are married. You know, I may be a little old school here, but I think we must maintain some boundaries in the choice of words we use. You know, for example, there is nothing funny in asking a married man or woman something like, "Where were you when I was looking for a husband or a wife?" And sometimes we do that even in the presence of this person's spouse. It may sound like a joke, but it is disrespectful at all levels. You may say, "Oh, but Laura, I'm just the crazy type. I joke around like that, but it doesn't mean anything." Well, my dear sister, my dear brother, aren't we all crazy in one way or the other? And even in that craziness, God has given each one of us enough self-control to respect ourselves and maintain some healthy boundaries in our interactions, knowing when to toe the line. As an event organizer and speaker, I have to work with lots of men in various capacities, and I'm always very conscious of what I say or write and how I do it. Nothing wrong in finding out how a business partner is doing, but I know that I just have to keep it professional. You know, I know the feeling, you know, if I read something that a lady has written to my husband, which I think is going in the wrong direction. So why would I want to do that to another woman? In the days of smileys and emoticons, we need to be conscious of how we use them. Ending a text message with a heart to your husband or your wife's friend just sends a wrong signal, at least to his or her partner. And please don't tell me about brotherly or sisterly love. It might not mean anything to you, but it could spark a fire in someone's bedroom. Proverbs 10 verse 10 says, "Whoever winks maliciously causes grief, and a chattering fool comes to ruin." The second area is meeting place. Yes, there will always be occasions where people have to meet. For example, you may travel to a faraway place and you're just excited about meeting someone who looks like you and maybe speaks your language. Social media has made it so easy to connect with nursery schoolmates and old neighbors and so on. So yes, I absolutely understand that men and women have to meet at some point or another. But there are some environments that are, let me just say, bad. I may be wrong, but two people who are not married to each other should never be alone in a hotel room or any other room, except the living room, of course. Yes, you do not plan to do anything. Yes, you're just excited to meet your old friend or your sister's friend's brother who is working in town this week. Yes, he or she knows you're married, but there are other places you can meet, right or wrong. I know we are living in modern days and we should be more relaxed and all, but I prefer to build my fences and maintain some boundaries. We have lost our sense of taboo and we wonder why things are going downhill. The next area is sharing information. Now that the meeting venue has been sorted, what next? How are we going to spend the time together? During dinner or at the cinema, what are we going to be talking about? You know, sharing emotional or personal problems or issues with someone of the opposite sex is very risky. I have heard many people say they finally found themselves in a tight spot because it got too emotional and someone needed to be comforted. I'm not saying we shouldn't share, but always know who you're sharing with and in what kind of atmosphere. Reminiscing about the good old days with a former schoolmate who maybe had something for you back in the days in your hotel room or maybe in the nightclub during your business trip is inviting trouble. Complaining about your spouse to your colleague or someone you just met whom you find interesting and kind could equally be a call for concern. Guess what? No one ever really goes out with the idea or goal to cheat on his or her spouse. But infidelity is causing serious damage on relationships today. Why? I believe most often it's because it just starts like a joke. You know, we are just going to have dinner. It's just a harmless meeting. You know, I just needed to vent. Then one thing leads to the next. And before we know it, well, my dear brother, my dear sister, adultery is not a joke. Cheating on your spouse is not a joke. Proverbs 6:32-33 says, "But a man who commits adultery has no sense. Whoever does so destroys himself. Blows and disgrace are his lot, and his shame will never be wiped away." And I think that is also valid for the woman. So, let us come to online chats and messages. You know, I really didn't want to find out how far I could have gone with a salesman who was bombarding me with love texts. I talked about that last time. I have been there also, you know, and I've also heard enough stories to know that engaging in such conversations is walking on very thin ice. So, my dear brother, my dear sister, I invite you today to take time to meditate on your interactions with the opposite sex. Pray and ask God to reveal anything you may be doing, consciously or unconsciously, which might be a ticking time bomb. Questions of the day. What is your main takeaway from today's meditation? Do you pay particular attention to the way you talk or write to people of the opposite sex? And when it comes to meeting places, are there any taboos for you? What experiences do you or someone you know have with sharing and discussing intimate things with someone of the opposite sex? What fences and boundaries have you set in these areas? Do you have any questions, inspirations, or testimonies to share? You know, come to think of it, what was it that made that salesman think he could write such text messages to me? Could I have given him some signals that, you know, made him believe I was interested in him? Was it the way I talked to him? What was it, maybe the way I behaved towards my husband? Was it my dressing or my body language? More on this when we return, God willing, on Monday. Let us pray. Heavenly and eternal Father, we thank you for the gift of a new day, for this fantastic Friday. King of glory, we worship you and we adore you. We praise and glorify your great name. Father, today you remind me of the importance of setting and maintaining boundaries in my life, especially in the area of my marriage. Father, as I go through life, I am sometimes confronted with situations which shake me to the core. Help me at such moments to exercise self-control and dignity. Grant me respect and self-control in my interactions with members of the opposite sex. May I also remember that what I may consider a joke or harmless could be a source of great pain and stress to another person. I pray especially for, and here you can mention any area of struggle. May your light continue to shine upon mankind. We thank you that you've healed the sick. We thank you that you've restored hope. We thank you that you've brought peace where there was war and fighting. We thank you that you've brought justice among the nations in Cameroon, in Kenya, in Nigeria, in Syria, in Afghanistan. We thank you that you've made a way where there seemed to be no way. Through Christ our Lord, we pray. Amen. God bless you. I'm Laura Tinzo, and this is Practical Theology. If this has been a blessing to you, go ahead and share and bless someone else. I wish you a very, very wonderful weekend in the Lord. Bye-bye.